Welcome back. Also, the nice weather has returned and some migratory birds have returned to Finland also. That's really nice. So, the previous part of this lecture introduced important social aspects of conservation. Now we will discuss the economic perspective in more detail. The costs of conservation can be analyzed in various ways, and Zonation offers opportunities for not only direct cost calculations, but also indirect costs such as opportunity costs and transaction costs can be included in the prioritization. I will also explain how Zonation allows for replacement cost calculations and analyses, and we have several case study examples from various parts of the world. These are located in New Zealand, in South Africa, and then two case studies are represented by the Finnish context.
So far, our course has concentrated on conservation planning informed by biodiversity patterns and other ecological information and the threats on those factors. As I argued in part one of this lecture, we are globally in a situation where it is a necessity to pay more attention to human factors in conservation planning. Therefore, during the rest of the lectures, we now move on to the topics of conservation costs, the impacts of governance and decision making, and detecting conservation opportunities. We will start by examining ways to analyze conservation costs using Zonation. Zonation is, by default, a conservation planning software that gives the highest priority to biodiversity-related features that are incorporated into the analysis. Zonation can account for habitat quality and connectivity, as we have already learned. However, Zonation can also balance social factors with ecological value defined through the analysis inputs. To put it simply, here balancing basically means allocating prioritized locations according to more than one criteria. Zonation is able to produce information on direct costs of conservation, such as land acquisition payments, but it can also be used to analyze the magnitude of transaction and opportunity costs. Transaction costs are the total costs of realizing the planned action, including costs of conservation planning, implementation, and monitoring. Opportunity costs then refer to the value of lost economic opportunities, for example, the value of timber that cannot be logged as a forest is taken under protection. Replacement costs are created as a result of inclusion or exclusion of certain locations in a prioritization solution. Replacement costs can be measured either in economic or in ecological terms. If you remember the mountain range example from the video lecture on basic concepts of spatial conservation planning, you may recall that we learned about the principle of irreplaceability then. Irreplaceability means that a certain location is essential for the optimal solution. An ecological economist would say that the replacement cost of an irreplaceable location is too high to be paid for if measured in ecological value. However, only few locations tend to be irreplaceable, and thus we can usually apply the principles of flexibility and complementarity. This means the prioritization is able to produce alternative network solutions that are based on non-unique occurrences of biodiversity features across the landscape. Different sites in each solution form alternative networks where the locations complement each other by their attributes to achieve the defined conservation goals. Flexibility, or the ability to look for alternative sets of priority locations, creates both emerging and lost opportunities whose monetary value can, in turn, be calculated. Ecosystem disservices are functions or properties of ecosystems that cause harmful or unwanted effects to people. These include, for example, pest outbreaks in agriculture and springtime flooding. Zonation is able to treat ecosystem services as positive factors in the prioritization. It can also treat ecosystem disservices as negative factors if given negative weights in the analysis. Importantly, Zonation aims for a cost-efficient solution by default. This means it always measures the conservation benefits in relation to costs. A cost is always included. In a very basic zonation prioritization, the cost is calculated via the proportion of landscape remaining that is in terms of area. But as shown here, there are many options to make this basic cost consideration more refined. Finally, it is important to make a difference between cost efficiency and cost effectivity. In general sense, efficiency means doing things with low economic cost. A practice can be efficient if it is cheap but produces wonky results. Effectivity then means doing the right things to achieve a defined goal with any cost. Therefore, effective actions can be highly costly. To get good results with least cost, zonation works according to the cost efficiency principle, that is, the ability to use less resources in order to achieve better output. In zonation, this means aiming for a network of priority sites that is comprehensive, representative, and/or adequate for the least possible cost. Cost effectiveness then is the ability to use resources effectively in order to achieve the desired conservation outcomes. Cost effectiveness is a property of conservation implementation, and a cost efficient spatial prioritization makes the cost effective implementation possible. Let's have a closer look on how the replacement cost analysis works. Our question in this example is, how costly is a network of protected areas when the site selection is not done based on spatial prioritization, but some other criteria has already been used to designate the protected areas? The cost calculations in zonation are interpreted mainly using the performance curves. The x-axis here shows the inverse priority ranking done by zonation, meaning that the end result of the prioritization is actually at the beginning of the axis. There, all landscape has been removed by the iteration. Remember that zonation starts to work with the full landscape. The y-axis shows the average proportion remaining over all biodiversity features in the analysis. This so-called average performance is commonly used as a general measure of conservation value. The ideal unconstrained prioritization solution based on biodiversity features shows a nice curve that rises quickly from the origo. This means zonation is able to pack a significant proportion of overall conservation value within a small fraction of the analyzed landscape. But then we need to include the information on the pre-designated protected areas. We can do this by including a hierarchical removal mask into the analysis. The purple curve here shows a solution where certain locations or sites are forced into the top fraction of the prioritization. In this example, those sites that are masked in are protected areas that are selected based on some other criteria than computational spatial conservation prioritization. Hierarchical masks are often used to include social constraints in the zonation prioritizations. Sites can be either masked in or masked out. Those sites that are masked out from the top fraction could be, for example, urban regions or areas dedicated for industry, anything that is not purposeful to prioritize. Then back to the example. Let's say that our target level of protection is 20% of the landscape. With this target, we now have two alternative protected area network scenarios that we can compare to each other. The green scenario represents the zonation prioritization without constraints, and the purple scenario is constrained to the predetermined sites, which zonation has ranked according to conservation value. The difference in conservation value between the two scenarios along our target extent is called as biological replacement cost. It means the quantitative loss of conservation value when suboptimal protected areas are established in comparison to the ideal unconstrained solution based solely on biodiversity attributes. By looking at the y-axis, we see that the difference is roughly 40%. This means that with the ideal unconstrained solution, we could get 40% more biodiversity value under conservation when compared to the constrained solution with the same area. Then, if we choose the maximum possible conservation value achieved by the target extent of protection as our reference points, that is about 60% of all conservation value, we can calculate the economic replacement cost. The economic replacement cost tells us how much additional area would need to be protected and paid for to maintain equal conservation value if the suboptimal protected areas are established. Looking at the x-axis, we can say that the proportion of landscape under protection should be more than doubled if we would go with the constrained solution and still wish to protect the same amount of biodiversity values as with the ideal unconstrained solution at the target level. So the green scenario allows for protection of about 60% of all conservation value within 20% of the landscape, whereas the purple scenario would need a total of 45% of the whole landscape protected in order to safeguard the equal amount of conservation value. If we wish to calculate the economic replacement cost in monetary terms, it is quite straightforward to translate the y-axis into euros or other currency. We just need to calculate the area that equals the proportion of the landscape at a given point and allocate a monetary value to the area units. Another way is to include costs as an input layer. This is a more elaborate way to approach costs in zonation. It takes account that not all locations are of same economic value and assumes that protection always has a price, that is, no location has a cost estimate of zero. In this kind of a prioritization, conservation value of each site is divided by the cost of protecting that site so that conservation value per cost unit is maximized in the solution. Here we have an example of a study done by Leithwick and colleagues, which is one of the case studies we utilize during this course. Here marine areas at New Zealand coast that are important both in terms of protection and fishing were analyzed. Leithwick and colleagues equaled conservation cost with relative fishing intensity. This means that they calculated the costs of lost economic opportunity in relation to conservation. They developed four different analytical scenarios. The first scenario was called no cost, and it is depicted here with the blue lines. It had no built-in cost considerations, and the analysis was poorly based on biological attributes. The second scenario was called full cost, and it is shown here with solid green lines. It was otherwise similar to the first scenario, but it added fishing intensity to the prioritization as a cost layer, thus representing a full cost model. The third scenario, called BPA, which comes from benthic protection areas, and that is drawn with green lines in the figures, was similar to the blue no-cost scenario, but it had current protected areas masked in to the top fraction of the prioritization. The last scenario represented a modified cost, and it was based on three analyses with different refinements in the cost layer. It took into account, for example, differences in locations that either had fishing activity or were unfished. The results of the modified cost scenario are shown with dashed red lines. The upper figure panel shows the performance of each scenario in relation to conservation benefits, that is, average feature performance is plotted against the proportion of landscape under protection. Note that here the x-axis follows the progress of zonation prioritization. The starting point of the full landscape is at the left, and the end of the prioritization is at the right. The lower figure panel shows the opportunity cost of conservation in percents, meaning that conservation of all landscape gives 100% cost in all scenarios. The trick here is that different scenarios prioritize different locations. The blue scenario that did not include the cost information performs well in relation to overall conservation value, but it is the most expensive one. The full cost scenario with solid red lines removes locations with high fishing intensity first and retains economically less important locations into the top fraction of the prioritization. However, the full cost scenario is unable to give it the same conservation benefits as the no cost scenario. This is because some economically valuable locations are irreplaceable in relation to biological value. The green BPA curves then show a scenario that emphasizes biological value but has existing protected areas masked into the top fraction. Because the conservation benefit curve of the green scenario lies under the blue no-cost curve, we see that the current protected areas are established in a suboptimal way and there are important unprotected biodiversity values. In the cost panel, the green cost curve differs greatly from the blue curve. The reason is that they show a different thing. Because the blue scenario had no actual cost considerations, it only shows the cost measured in terms of area under protection. The green curve has the built-in cost information. It lies flat at the top fraction because those locations are already protected and thus only marginal additional conservation costs are born. The modified cost analysis shows the most realistic and cost-efficient scenario where conservation benefits are considerable and they can be achieved with relatively low costs. Next, we have an example on boreal major protection in Finland by Nieminen and colleagues, and this article is currently in press. Majors are especially tricky to protect because they tend to require large continuous areas to be set aside for protection. This is because major ecosystem functions as hydrological entities and they are susceptible to changes within their water catchment areas. Majors, as well as other wetlands, are threatened ecosystems that need to be conserved as large entities in order to achieve long-term benefits for biodiversity and ecosystem functions, including carbon sequestration. In Finland, major conservation has largely been implemented on state-owned land, but important biodiversity values lie on privately owned majors, where the land ownership is highly fragmented. Conservation actions on private land need to take local landowners' perspectives into account. When using a 100% voluntary conservation approach, just one resisting landowner can halt the protection of a biodiverse major. The analysis was done on a national scale. The prioritization model consisted of following things. Firstly, hydrological major entities were included as planning units. 91 biodiversity features, including data on habitat types and species occurrences, were included. Ditching level was included as a condition layer, as major ditching has been common in Finland and it directly deteriorates the major ecosystem structures and functions. A cost layer was also included and it consisted of land area price, tree stand value and administrative costs, all in euros. Existing protected areas were included as a hierarchical removal mask to force them into the top fraction of the prioritization. Then vegetation zones were included as so-called administrative units. They were used in order to account for biogeographical variation in habitat and species distributions. Then interaction connectivity was used to emphasize the connectivity of candidate sites for additional conservation in relation to existing protected mires. Then information on landowners' resistance to protection was added in order to create three different scenarios. In the voluntary scenario, all candidate mires where at least one owner resisted protection were excluded from protection. The exclusion happened regardless of the biodiversity representation of these mires or the financial costs of their protection. In the obligatory scenario, mires with high biodiversity representation but low costs were prioritized. Landowners' conservation resistance was ignored in the obligatory scenario. This rough implementation of land expropriation is possible and has been done historically on the basis that Finnish legislation demands that if land is forcefully taken under conservation, the landowner must receive an appropriate payment in exchange. In the balancing scenario, landowner resistance was considered and avoided in the prioritization, but not led to overrule high biodiversity values. Here resistance was included to the site selection as a percentual proportion for each planning unit, and it was weighted negatively in the analysis. The idea was that if most landowners of one mire are willing to protect the mire, a few resisting landowners could be persuaded to accept the protection, giving the rightful compensation. As a result, the balancing scenario simultaneously avoided mires with most landowners resisting protection while emphasizing higher biodiversity value and low conservation costs. All right, let's get into the results. They are presented as performance curves that are plotted using three axes. The x-axis shows the percentage of additional mire protection in relation to a preselected set of mires, excluding existing protected areas. The preselection of these so-called candidate mires was done by an expert group, and there was a total of 1,533 candidate mires with a combined coverage of 3,273 square kilometers. In this chart, the top fraction of the prioritization lies at the left-hand end of the x-axis. On the left-hand y-axis, we have two variables that have the same range of values. First, we have the average biodiversity feature representation under protection, that is, the total conservation value of the prioritized network. Secondly, we have the landowner's level of resistance. Both are in percents. Then, on the right-hand y-axis, we have the economic costs of establishing protection, and this is shown in millions of euros. These are the resulting performance curves. There are a total of three prioritizations and three curves or lines for each prioritization analysis. The three scenarios are represented with color shading. Dark color refers to the voluntary protection scenario, light color for the obligatory protection scenario, and intermediate color refers to the balancing scenario where some landowner resistance was allowed for. The green lines refer to the average representation of biodiversity features in each of the three runs or scenarios. Note that the green lines do not start from the origo. This is because the amount of conservation value retained within the existing protected areas are not shown here. The existing protected areas have about 54% of the total biodiversity feature representation, and they cover a total of 65% of all area that was included in the prioritization. However, because these results focus on the additional protection, the proportions of belonging to protected mires are left out from the graph. Then the red lines show conservation resistance by the private landowners according to the three scenarios. These numbers start from zero logically, as the landowners of protected mires are not included. Blue lines show the cost of additional conservation, and these two start from the zero. By looking at the dark red line, that is the level of resistance within the voluntary scenario, we can spot the limit of voluntary conservation. At this point of the voluntary scenario, the landowner resistance is 0%. For the voluntary scenario, this straight line drawn from that point upwards functions as a delimitator between those candidate mires whose landowners are willing to protect their mire. They are on the left, and on the right we have those mires that have resisting landowners. The line lies roughly at 35% of candidate mires protected, equaling an area of 1,154 square kilometers that could be protected using the voluntary approach. How much conservation value would this Maya network based on voluntary protection hold then? We see that from the left-hand side y-axis. Taking into account also the biodiversity feature representation on already protected mires, the combined conservation value according to the voluntary scenario is 68% of all conservation value within the prioritization. Then the costs. Establishing the additional protection according to the landowner voluntariness would cost a total of 97 million euros. So far, so good. These were the main results of the voluntary protection scenario. How does the voluntary protection scenario compare to the obligatory protection scenario? Now we look at the light shade lines, and let's start with the conservation value that is in green. Remember that this is another prioritization run, and the values are calculated from a different set of prioritized sites. If we were to protect the same amount of biodiversity, 68%, as in the voluntary scenario, we would need a lot less area if landowner resistance was ignored. Only 625 square kilometers of mires would be needed, that is a little over half of the area demanded by the voluntary scenario. This is quite straightforward, because in the obligatory scenario, additional protection can be targeted in the most cost-efficient way regarding biodiversity attributes. So, what are the actual costs? Protecting the same amount of conservation value with less area when compared to the voluntary scenario would cost only 28 million euros if obligatory protection could be used. But then, now we have the social costs, and those are measured in terms of landowner resistance. In the obligatory scenario, the total resistance of landowners is quite high, 17%. This means that there is a trade-off between conservation value and landowners' acceptance of protection. Could that trade-off be alleviated using the balancing scenario? It was the one that relied on the ability of people to negotiate on conservation actions, so that if landowner resistance was low on some mires, those mires could be nudged into protection more easily. So the balancing scenario took into account all three factors: biodiversity values, conservation costs, and landowner resistance. Let's start with the conservation value and the extent of prioritized network again. To retain the magical number of 68% of conservation value, the balancing scenario requires additional protection of only 598 square kilometers of mires. So the same amount of biodiversity could be protected with even less area when compared to the voluntary and the obligatory scenarios. This is explained by the fact that there are biologically highly valuable mires that have only few landowners that resist protection, and the balancing scenario is able to prioritize also those sites, whereas the voluntary scenario was forced to leave those sites out of the site selection. When compared to the obligatory scenario, the balancing scenario is able to find good replacement mires for those sites with high conservation value but more resisting landowners. because the total area of additional protection is low as compared to other scenarios, also the costs of conservation are the lowest according to the balancing scenario. This looks almost too good to be true. What about the social cost, landowners' resistance? Actually, the level of resistance lies at 5%, which is not bad at all. This means that if some room is given to negotiations in implementation of bioprotection, the gained biodiversity benefits can be very good in relation to the used resources. So, what did we learn from this case study? Trade-offs among ecological, economic, and social issues are unavoidable in conservation. It seems that there is no such concept in conservation as win-win solutions. However, the trade-offs should always be studied before making decisions. Total voluntariness, that is categorical exclusion of resisted sites, is very expensive both in monetary and in ecological terms. Cost differences between alternative protection scenarios reveal opportunities for more cost-effective conservation, also without land expropriations. Site selection should be made as objectively as possible. Here it is important to remember that choosing either involuntary or voluntary conservation approaches are both value choices. Exclusion of alternative strategies a priori can prevent us to see opportunities that could lead to more successful conservation. And finally, conservation cannot be done cost effectively within a black and white mindset. Conservationists need to be open to new ideas and practices, and the inclusion of social constraints may open up new opportunities for conservation. Whew, time to look for that lovely landscape of the protected Repoaapamajo for a couple of seconds. Okay, let's continue. Let's change the location from Finland to Africa. KwaZulu-Natal is a province in South Africa where Diminin and colleagues conducted a multi-objective conservation planning study. This was a highly developed zonation analysis that took into account both biological and social aspects of conservation, including livelihoods and opportunity costs. They studied the combination of biodiversity protection, sustainable development, and spatial land use guidance in the resolution of potential policy conflicts over priority areas for conservation at risk of transformation due to land use pressures. Economic development and a rapidly growing human population are threatening biological diversity in the KwaZulu-Natal region. In their analysis, Diminin and colleagues included opportunity cost calculations for 28 alternative land uses among four categories, which were mining, commercial forestry, agriculture, and conservation businesses. The profitabilities of different land uses vary a lot spatially. Three selected land use profitability maps are shown here, and you can see that whereas forestry, that is the map in the middle, is profitable along the coastline in the east, agriculture is more profitable at the inland. Spatial overlap among the land use profitabilities indicate possible conflicts among livelihoods unless the co-occurring land uses can be combined together. In this study, economic benefits for conservation businesses were estimated in a stepwise manner. Ecotourism in the study area generates profit from overnight stays and park entrance fees. This makes it a livelihood that has synergies with biodiversity conservation. Here the steps in developing data on monetary value of conservation businesses are shown. These calculations resulted in the profitability estimate for ecotourism. First, tourists' preferences in terms of environmental attributes needed to be understood. Species of big game were emphasized as they are known to be charismatic and draw tourists' attention. Then the distributions of these attractive species were mapped. A biodiversity supply map was then created by overlaying individual habitat suitability models for tourists' favorite species, including the lion, elephant, leopard, and black rhino. The biodiversity supply map was then overlaid with a layer on accessibility based on data from major transportation infrastructure and airports to account for distance and travel time to the tourism sites. Finally, Demining and colleagues used tourists' visitation data and the average price paid by each tourist to calculate the gross revenue in US dollars per unit area and per year. Also, in this case study, the researchers ran several different zonation analyses for alternative land use categories and compared the results of these scenarios. Let's first look at the priority maps. Each of them shows in red the top 10% fraction of area for a single land use category. The least valuable areas are shown in green. Spatial overlap among the priority areas generally indicates conflicts in land use. In the case of the two upper maps that show the priority areas for conservation businesses and biodiversity, also synergies can exist in overlapping priority areas. Spatial separation then indicates that by land use planning, the current conflicts can be reduced and future conflicts can be avoided. The performance curves for different prioritization scenarios are shown here in more detail. They describe the mean representation of analyzed biodiversity features at a given level of location removal, which proceeds from left to right. Separate curves are drawn from the average conservation value in terms of biodiversity features, which is shown by solid lines and the four land use categories that have dashed lines. In the lower graphs, bio is a scenario that only prioritized biodiversity features. NOB is a scenario opposite to bio, as it gave the highest value to agriculture, commercial forestry, and conservation businesses, but did not include conservation of biodiversity. You can see that the solid line of conservation value performs well in bio, but drops down in NOB. In the upper graphs, all refers to a scenario where all land uses were considered and existing protected areas were not masked in. This scenario aimed for a balanced solution among all land uses. ALP refers to a similar balanced scenario with all land uses considered, but taking into account the existing protected areas that were masked in. So, this detailed conservation planning assessment combines spatial distribution models for 646 biodiversity features, spatial economic return models or profitability maps for 28 land uses, and spatial data on four threats, which included invasive species, unsustainability, roads, and urbanization. The results demonstrated that nature-based tourism businesses could provide revenues of over $60 million per year while helping to protect 50% of the conservation value in the planning region. When all land uses and the opportunity costs were considered together in the same analysis, the spatial conflicts between biodiversity values, agriculture, commercial forestry, and mining were decreased. Ecotourism is a growing business in Africa and elsewhere, which is well demonstrated by this photograph and the story that accompanies it. The photographer tells, "Necking giraffes in Ithala Game Reserve, Northern KwaZulu-Natal Province, South Africa. They slammed their heads into each other with absolutely horrifying force. We sat watching this fight for over an hour. The one on the left lost. His timing was none too good. So he tended to miss and then take the other one right in the throat. His tactic was to push the other one into a nearby thorn tree, pretty much destroying the tree in the process, and almost into my car. I had to move in a hurry. But after 20 or 30 thundering hits in the neck of the chest, he gave up." Now, to end this lecture, let's return back to Finland and take a more small-scale example on land use trade-offs. Also in Finland, livelihoods need to be considered in spatial planning together with conservation value. In the Finnish context, timber production is an extremely important ecosystem service, as 76% of the total land area is covered by forests, and commercial forestry is one of the most important industries. In addition to timber production, forests provide also other important ecosystem services, among which recreation is highly valued due to the wide usage of everyman's rights or rights of access, that is jokamiehen oikeudet in Finnish. Also, climate change mitigation through methane release avoidance from peatlands and carbon storage increase in forests is very important. This case study by Räsänen and colleagues focused on the region of Luopioinen located in Pirkanmaa province, southern Finland. Luopioinen is a rural area with a surface of 390 square kilometers. The figure here shows three ecosystem service maps of the study area. A for timber production, B for carbon sequestration, and C for creational values. In figure panels A and B, only forest and peatland areas are considered. Figure panel D then shows areas with high timber value in green and high conservation value in red. Areas where spatial trade-offs between timber and conservation emerged are shown in black. Also in the D panel, only areas on forestland and peatland are drawn, hence there are also areas of other habitat types with high conservation value that are not drawn here. Conservation value depicted in panel D was mapped using zonation with connectivity included, and no value was given to human settlements. As seen in the amount of black color, the conservation value distribution had high correlation with the timber value map. An important conclusion from this and the other case studies presented in this lecture is this. Because of spatial trade-offs, land use planning should always be done with multiple objectives in mind. Otherwise, the trade-offs may significantly hinder the implementation of planned conservation action. Thank you for viewing.